Salutations, everybody. It is Maddie here today. I was originally editing a completely different video as of 1 minute ago, but then the news broke that E3 2023 is canceled. And naturally, I wanted to sit down and talk about that instead because this is significant, not only because a major show that is of great importance to gamers has been canceled yet again, but this likely marks the final nail in the coffin for E3. And as E3 has slowly wound down and died a very slow death, might I add, I've been pretty quiet on the matter, only commenting really on Twitter, but I think this is it for the show. And it's really sad to see, honestly. I've always liked E3. I enjoyed attending E3. I enjoyed working the show floor at E3. I know most people who express their issues with E3 typically work in the media, where they have a much different set of circumstances than I can schedule appointments for what I'm interested in, check out whatever I'm interested in, skip what I'm not. Very different from the media. So there is some celebration out there for those who work in games, but I think as a fan of games and as someone who has worked the show floor, I'm sad to pretty much see it go. We're gonna cover how this all happened, how we got to this point, and then I'll share more thoughts. But ladies and gentlemen, if you are new here and you are into all this gaming news and information, consider subscribing. So this really started about, I'd say, a couple of weeks ago when we started to see major players pull out of E3. When Nintendo wasn't showing up, I found that to be a minor red flag, but not anything to sound all the alarms for. It's when Xbox pulled out that I thought, okay, we just saw Developer Direct. That was a tremendous success. Xbox has always been vocally supportive of E3. I'm very surprised to see them not show up. They have always seemed to have a consistent presence for E3. For them not to show up, that was my first red flag. Afterwards, we learned through Video Games Chronicle that Ubisoft would no longer be attending E3 and in fact hosting its very own event in June, which is something they can do and have done in the past. They're typically not on the show floor. From my experience, they went to a completely different theater in LA and hosted their own showcase, but they were a part of the E3 week. For them to bow out, especially with all their struggles, again, I found to be pretty significant. And then to follow that up with Sega and even Tencent announcing they will not be attending E3 and noting, according to a report from IGN, that there's been a significant lack of communication from the organizers at both ReedPop and the ESA, and that they haven't heard of anyone else planning to attend, I think the writing was on the wall. And it didn't take very long for us to find out it's been canceled, as IGN again reported that the show has been canceled after huge gaming companies like Nintendo, Microsoft, Ubisoft, and so on have all said they will not be participating. According to an email sent to employees and verified by IGN, E3 2023, quote, simply did not garner the sustained interest necessary to execute it in a way that would showcase the size, strength, and impact of our industry, end quote. Now, I mentioned, oh man, it's kind of a bummer that E3 is going, and I'll have more thoughts on that. But you know who's really not mourning the passing of E3 is Jeff Keighley, the host of the Summer Games Fest, among many other things like the Game Awards. He took to Twitter, and my man was getting spicy out there, no doubt about it. He definitely had a pack watch moment for sure, as he posted on Twitter, here's 15-year-old me at my first ever E3 in 1995, the year I was born, by the way. E3 meant so much to me and to so many of you too. 4 years ago, I realized that E3 wasn't evolving as it needed to compete in a global digital world. So we started building what's next. See at Summer Games Fest on June 8th, and then a separate promo tweet, joined together to celebrate what's next in video games at the Summer Games Fest, which returns Thursday, June 8th, streaming live everywhere. The body hasn't even been buried yet. We haven't had the funeral yet, and Jeff is popping bottles and saying, hey, here's what's next. Come on board. Because, again, the writing on the wall is evidently showing E3 is probably done. We've seen them try to come back in a digital format. They've tried to come back in what is a hybrid sort of physical digital format this year, where they're saying you don't gotta be on the show floor. Seemingly pretty fluid. They got ReedPop involved, who handles PAX East, and outside of this past PAX East, where the enforcers were ridiculous compared to usual, I'd say PAX East is a really well-run event, and they definitely understand what fans want and how to organize things properly, where I felt this was a good move and step in the right direction. But now the ReedPop president has stepped down as of a couple of weeks ago. So everything's getting a little bit messy. And with E3 going, we no longer have that central point in the summer where there's a concentrated amount of announcements. Now, given the pattern of the industry, you're going to see more throughout the summer, but I anticipate, as it's been for a little bit now, they're only going to get more spread out. And I do have mixed feelings on this. For example, the Summer Games Fest and the Game Awards can be pretty good. I actually enjoyed the Game Awards this past year when it came to announcements and reveals. I don't recall walking away with any issues and thought it was actually one of the stronger ones that Jeff Keighley has put on. However, there have definitely been showcases he's hosted where it's updates on things we already know about, and it's not necessarily as exciting. And we know sometimes Jeff does generate that high level of hype going into his shows, which I love, by the way. I love his passion. I love his energy. I think it's sorely needed in our industry where we're full of people from the media constantly whining about what is such an amazing job to do. I think it's great to have someone who's leading these showcases genuinely enthusiastic about what they do. But with that, the showcases have been inconsistent and not every company gets involved. And with that means that you get the more spread out showcases. As a YouTuber, actually, that's great because I don't have to have that drought through July, through August where I go, oh my God, what are we going to talk about? Because everyone, you know, shot out all the news back in June. That was how it used to be. These last 3 years, it's just been a consistent news cycle all year round, and companies are just becoming more fluid, doing their own digital events whenever. And as a creator, it's fun. As a fan of games and as a consumer, I vastly prefer the much more concentrated shotgun blast 1 week news extravaganza that is E3, where it's just 3 days of announcements, gameplay, and news. But that's as a fan. As a business, I understand why these companies want to do their own thing on their own time. When you're going to E3, you're just competing with everybody. And this seemed like a natural step in the right direction for the industry, which is number one, to make it where it's not just the hottest times of the year are June and the fall. Now we have fun stuff happening all year, but also the excitement can strike at any time. Make no mistake, while I think this is overall necessary for the industry to grow, I think some people are a little too quick to pop bottles on this one. I think E3 is going to be sorely missed, and I don't know if Summer Games Fest is going to be that type of replacement that we're looking for, where it's the E3 we knew and loved. As Jeff said, it needed to evolve beyond that. But I do think there was power in that excitement, that announcement hype, and of course the legendary moments of E3 that we know and have seen before, whether it be Xbox announcing 5 different studio acquisitions or PlayStation absolutely twisting the knife on Xbox with the used games fiasco. There were so many prominent moments in gaming history, many of them happening at E3. It's one of those things where you just have to imagine it would never go anywhere. And the fact that it looks like it's on its way out, it's sad. I'm not going to sit here and pretend to be excited because I enjoyed working E3, but I'm also keen to see and open-minded to this future we're going toward. I never understood why, for example, companies put on these in-person events and invited content creators like myself and other press outlets to these in-person events to play games hands-on when we're in such a digitized world, especially gaming, where you could do those previews, those impressions through the computer, whether it be sending a preview build or even in my experience, streaming the game through Parsec. These are all ways we can experience the game online. And the reason I bring that up is because this saves money for these companies. What also saves money is not spending cash on show floor space. Obviously, these companies will reserve that type of stuff to decide for marketing or whatever budget they want to allocate it towards. But this can save them a lot of money if they don't have to plan for E3. It's a lot less stress. And when you look at Nintendo, now Xbox, now PlayStation, they each have their own presentation format that have been massively successful. State of Play has been successful. We haven't seen a major PlayStation showcase since September of 2021, which is crazy to think about. You have Nintendo Directs, which speak for themselves. And now Xbox, they started Developer Direct this year, and I'm a big believer in that format. Why would you go to E3? Why would you need E3? They each have a platform of their own, and I like the disconnected, independent vibe the industry has transformed into, but the old school head in me is definitely going to miss that connected. Everything's happening in one week. You got to tune in every day. And also that feeling of being a week or two out from E3 and seeing news that, you know, happened the week of, but you missed it because there was so much happening. Again, that's where the fan reality collides with the business reality. The business hearing that goes, no. We want you to be hearing about our news when it breaks, not weeks after. So I get why this is beneficial to all parties involved. And certainly Jeff has the platform that has proven it. I always think back to when Xbox did not show off Halo at their own Gamescom showcase, but in fact brought it over to opening night live with Jeff Keighley. And that to me said it all. The numbers, the reach that his platforms have across the Game Awards, Opening Night Live, and Summer Games Fest speak for themselves, and that's why these companies are participating in that and not E3. Funny enough, E3 has commented on the matter. We already knew they were teaming up with GamesIndustry.biz to publish all the information happening during E3, and they actually interviewed the head of the ESA on what the plans are moving forward. So at the very bottom of the interview, the question is the plan for E3 to return in 2024? And the answer is, we're committed to providing an industry platform for marketing and convening, but we want to make sure we find that right balance that meets the needs of the industry. We're certainly going to be listening and ensuring whatever we want to offer meets those needs, and at that time, we will have more news to share. So unlike when they have failed to deliver on E3 in the past, they have been very quick to commit that there is something on the way. It looks like they are collecting themselves and trying to re-strategize. This does not affect their advocacy plans where they would go to bat for policymakers and whatnot, but this does in fact change how they're approaching the show and how they want to get the entire industry to convene. And they need to figure out what would fit the needs of pretty much what the Summer Games Fest is now doing for all of these companies. So unfortunately, it looks like E3 well and truly is out, at least for the foreseeable future. But yeah, all of this article is really just covering how they need to find a way to address the needs of the industry. And after all this time, you'd think they know, but clearly they don't. That's where the ESA stands on the cancellation of their own show, however. I think especially so, this is just a death of a thousand cuts. E3 probably could have lived, is the sad part about this all. But between leaking the press credentials, silence on communication, confusing plans, they really did a number on themselves. And so it's their fault at the end of the day. And they absolutely could have weathered the storm and found a way and reinvented and overhauled. But as one company pulled out, the dominoes truly began to fall. And wow, just sad to see, but crazy news nonetheless. E3 is not happening this year. I'm glad I did not book my flight. I'm glad I did not book my hotel, because as a fan, I was really looking forward to checking it out, what I thought would be one last time. It's crazy to think. I went to E3 in 2018, and when I left that building, I did not think that would be my last E3. But it is what it is, I suppose. I have great memories of it, and I feel bad for gamers who hear nothing but good stuff about it and always dreamed of attending. You know, I remember teenage me, all I wanted, beyond even this job, all I wanted to go to E3. There was a status to it, and it's gone now. And I think we as an industry lose something with that. So I know we're going to see a lot of celebrating in the streets. I'm personally not going to be celebrating too hard. I'm happy we're moving into this more independent, stronger industry, but E3, make no mistake, is a substantial loss in my book. You may disagree, and that's totally cool with me, but that's just how I feel about it. So with that, ladies and gentlemen, let me know what you think about E3 down below. I'm looking forward to seeing your thoughts. Other than that, be sure to follow me on Twitter, follow me on Instagram. Those links are in the description down below. And a big thank you to all the patrons, all the members who continue to support the heck out of the content here. Stay sexy, stay active. I love you all. Peace.